Thank you. So, brother
Pastor Bruce,
Chuck, yes.
How are you this morning?
Fine, and you?
Good, good. Isn't it great to see all these beautiful people?
I did see a couple.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Hey, I heard that we had a 50th wedding anniversary in the last week or so.
No, 50 years?
Yeah, yeah, Ned and Ray Brummel.
Oh, give them a big hand, Ned and Ray. And in Ned's honor, let's all chant, Go Cardinals. Go Cardinals. No, just kidding, Ned. I'm just kidding.
Hey,
congratulations.
Dan started this week as our full-time ministry coordinator and youth minister. So, yeah. Yeah, and he wanted to make an announcement quickly.
Oh, hey. So, let me think. What was it? Yes. Kids who were in fifth and sixth grade last year, this last academic year, but are going into sixth and seventh, are very welcome to the youth program. So we have Wednesday nights, 6 to 8 in the evening. And then Sunday mornings, of course, we have a Bible study we do. That's 9:30, just before church. So please feel free to come. In fact, you have to. I just got to. I'm being a little aggressive, I guess. But yeah, you have to. And then what was else? Ah, youth volunteers and parents of the youth. I encourage them to help me shape the program, kind of give me feedback, because it's hard for me to admit this, but sometimes I don't know everything. I'm glad not as many people laughed as I anticipated. But so I really appreciate when parents chip in, give me feedback, kind of help me brainstorm on the program, how to develop it and stuff like that. I call it the Youth Council. I already have some good people in it. But I like to have as many brains helping me as possible. So if you are interested, come to me at the end of church or at some point today, and we'll swap contact info, and I'll start inviting you to that process. All right, that's all I got.
Thanks, Dan. VBS is coming up, Vacation Bible School. It's going to be the week of Sunday, July 10th through Thursday, July 14th. It'll be in the evenings. And we've got a couple of great volunteers who are going to be heading that up in Betsy Rush and Stacy Spradlin. And they've asked if we could get some volunteers. We're going to need a lot of hands on deck to help pull that off. And specifically volunteers for Sunday evenings. And there's a... I didn't mean to say Sunday evenings. I meant to say for the meals. So, Stacy, do you want to say anything specifically about it? Because I don't want to screw up your announcement.
This year we want to really try to make this a successful first year for Vacation Bible School coming back to this church. And Betsy and I are working really hard on getting decorations together and getting coordinators and all that kind of stuff to get all of the different sections led correctly. So we will have a sign-up sheet out in the lobby area after church today. We have different commitment levels for everybody. Don't think that you have to, you know, head anything up. We definitely have room for that if you want to take on a bigger commitment, but also if you can only be here a couple of nights that week, that'll be fine too, but we can discuss the specifics out. So just please keep in mind and prayerfully consider volunteering for Vacation Bible School.
Yes, please, please, please. Thank you. In a couple of Sunday nights, we're going to have our second faith night, and it's going to be July 3rd. I know that's right around an important holiday, so we're actually going to be tying it into praying for our nation and looking at how faith has played such an important role in our nation. But we'll also be looking at it on the personal level, as we'll have a special guest testimony that night from somebody in our church. I'm going to wait and tell you who next week, okay? Okay. I think that may be all. One thing you might want to join some of us for is the Family Faith Night at the Quincy Gems next Sunday night at 4 p.m. So come on out. I know a few of us are planning to go, so it'd be a fun night. Come out and enjoy the baseball game. Crossing Worship is going to play, I think, after the game. You can read the details and read any other announcements that are in your program today, okay? Happy Father's Day to all our fathers. Why don't we go ahead and stand on up. Welcome, everybody. And we'll get ready for worship here in just a minute.
myriad people together are gathering this day to praise our Savior Jesus Christ. To us, he is beautiful. To us, he means everything because of all the love that he's poured out for us. We stand today to unashamedly say, we believe in God our Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit and the new life that is ours in him.
In this time of Savior's love through the storm.
darkness seems to hide its face. I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds me.
God, You are our cornerstone. You are the everlasting Father. And God, as we celebrate and thank You for our earthly fathers today, Lord, they're all going to fail us at times. They're all going to disappoint us at times. Some can't. They're not going to live forever. Some of our fathers aren't here with us today. And God, we're so thankful for the way that You move through them to bless our lives for so many of us. But God, remind us that everything in this life will fail except for You. You are the one cornerstone. You're the one thing that never changes, that never moves. And so, God, we come today to say, Lord, we believe in You. You are our foundation. And God, I pray that You would draw us in closer to You, God. Make our commitment to You stronger today. Let us leave with a closer relationship with You today that doesn't shift and change, but that's solid and firm as we place all of ourselves, all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, loving and following You, God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. While Jim Percy's up here, I want to see if Bruce will hand him the microphone and share for a minute about our retreat that's coming up. We've got an all-church family retreat. Doesn't matter if you're single, if you're older, if you're younger, if you've got kids, whatever. We'd love for everybody who wants to come. We've got special funds set aside. If it's difficult for you to pay your way, we would like to know. If you want to come, please let us know by the end of next month, and you can find out more details. But if you've never come and you want to think about it, maybe Jim will give you some more reasons to consider coming. Jim?
So, we were fairly new to the church last year when we went to the first retreat, and that was actually good for us. I know there's some fairly new faces here that have been here in the last year. And the wonderful thing about the retreat is we don't really get to know each other that well here Sunday mornings. We have a little snack time afterwards and stuff like that, but we really don't get an in-depth get to know each other. And the thing that I loved about the retreat is we got to know and really get to fellowship with fellow Christians and fellow believers here in the church. And for me, you know, I probably made some misconceptions about some people that went to the retreat. And those misconceptions were all washed away when we went there because you get to know the person. You might see him in church wearing a fancy dress or a fancy tie or whatever and think, well, I don't know about him. But realistically, you know, we're all Christians and we're all believers. And the wonderful thing about that retreat was being able to just wash all those misconceptions away and get to know the heart of each other. The other thing that was really great is just that time of fellowship and prayer with each other. Chuck has been talking a lot about prayer for the nation and prayer for each other. And the retreat is a wonderful time for that prayer. You get to know each other, the hearts of each other, and you can pray with each other and just spend that quality time together. It's a wonderful time away from the church building here in the regular Sunday mornings that we see each other, just to get to really fellowship and know each other a lot better. So if you can make it, I hope you can go. If you can't, please talk to Chuck and see if there's a way to get you there if you feel it's a burden to go this year.
Yeah. Thanks so much, Jim. You know, it is something that I consider so important to the life of our church, to really growing into the future together. The early church, one of the things that's said about them, they spent time together. And so this is a wonderful time to be able to just go away and get together. Even if you can only go for, say, Saturday and you can't stay the whole time, that's all right. We can make that happen too. We just love to have you there however you can get there, all right? The choir's back. Let's welcome the choir back. Couple weeks break. And we can't wait to hear from you.
Thank you.
things going on right now. I forget to turn on my microphone. And also, I meant to mention, I did not include in the week's calendar the Supper Club that's happening on Monday night. And they are meeting, where are you guys eating? Maya at 6. So just another occasion to get together, enjoy a meal together. Today's Father's Day, as we've already said. And I'd love to take a time right now just to pray a special prayer for our fathers that are with us, as well as to remember those that aren't here. So would you grab the hand next to you as we pray together? God, we thank you for what you've created in creating a family. The love and the comfort and the security, the guidance, the teaching that happens. Lord, it gets hectic. Sometimes there are difficulties. But Lord, we thank you so much, especially today, for the fathers that you have put into our lives. For so many of us, they have meant just countless, indescribable blessings. There's no value that we could place on so many of our dads. And so, God, all we can ask today for them is that you would bless them, that you would shine your face on them, that you would let them know that you love them. And Lord, we pray for our fathers as well. And we ask that in this year ahead, that you would help them to do the difficult jobs that dads have to do sometimes, to set boundaries or to teach and lead by example, to continue to work and provide. God, we pray that you would allow them to be godly men. And Lord, we remember as well today those that aren't here with us. And still in their memory, we thank you for them. And if they're still alive and they're just not in the room here today, we ask that you would manifest your presence and your blessing to them wherever they are. We pray all these things in your name. Amen. I think the final thing I need to say before we take this morning's offering is that if you are a guest with us, we'd love for you to fill out the guest card. We've got two different versions here, and we'd love for you to just drop that in the offering as your gift to us this morning, under no obligation to give as the plates pass you by. I noticed on one of these welcome cards there are a lot of questions. You don't have to fill out all those questions. We just love to know your name and how to let you know that we're glad that you came. So with that said, children may be dismissed. Ushers, please come forward, and we will take this morning's offering.
Thank you.
Thank you, David. I wasn't sure that was the prelude to the tune of the doxology. I wasn't sure if we'd sing or not, but it was awesome. Thank you. Stay standing. We're going to sing two verses of 293, or it's on the screens in front of you. This is My Father's Will.
I love you, I worship, I adore you, glorify your name in all the earth. Glorify your name. Sing with me how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God. One more time. How great is our God. Sing with me how great is our God, and all we'll see how great is our God. We exalt thee, very simply, we exalt thee, we'll be celebrating fatherhood is nothing more than acknowledging that God is our Heavenly Father, understanding that He loves you and He loves me, understanding that He built this world so that we could have fellowship with Him, so that we could love Him, so that not only would we worship Him, but we would fellowship with Him. He is the ultimate Father. And then He brought along dads. He's our Abba Father, by the way. What's that mean? Daddy Father. So the question this morning is, who's your daddy? Who is your daddy? Back in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, thanks, Chuck, a young seminary professor was eating lunch in a restaurant. And as he was eating lunch in a restaurant, he happened to notice a man who was all dressed up going from one diner to another, one patron to another. And he noticed that he would stop and talk to each one of them. And he would hear him say, "Hey, hey, where are you folks from?" And they would tell him. And so finally he got to this young seminary professor. And he said, and of course the young seminary professor was kind of like you are on a Sunday morning when the pastor's roaming around in between the pews, or I'm going down the aisle and you're going, "Oh my gosh, I hope he doesn't come to me. Don't ask me to say anything. I don't want to talk to this guy." And that's what the young seminary professor was thinking. And yet, that kindly old gentleman stopped at his table. He said, "Hey, where are you folks from?" "Oklahoma," they answered. "Great to have you here in Tennessee. What do you do for a living?" "I teach in a seminary," the professor replied. "Oh, so you teach preachers how to preach, do you? Well, I've got a really good story for you." "Well, you know how that goes." The professor's going, "Oh, no, not another story." He said, "See that mountain over there?" He pointed out the restaurant window. "Not far from the base of that mountain, there was a boy born to an unwed mother. He had a hard time growing up because every place he went, he was always asked, 'Hey, boy, who's your daddy?' Whether he was at school, in the grocery store, or drugstore, or wherever, people would ask him the same question, 'Who's your daddy?' He would hide at recess and lunchtime from other students. He would avoid going into stores because that question hurt him so much. When he was about 12 years old, a new preacher came to his church, and he would always go in late and slip out early to avoid hearing the question, 'Hey, boy, who's your daddy?' But one day, the new preacher said the benediction so fast, the boy got caught and had to walk out with the crowd. And just about the time he got to the back door, the new preacher, not knowing anything about the young man, put his hand on his shoulder and asked him, 'Son, who's your daddy?' The whole church got deathly quiet. He could feel every eye in the church looking at him. Now everyone would know, finally know the answer to the question, 'Who's your daddy?' The new preacher, though, sensed that the situation around him was tense. And using discernment that only the Holy Spirit could give, he said the following to the scared little boy, "Wait a minute. I know who you are. I see the family resemblance now. You're a child of God." And with that, he patted the boy on the shoulder and said, "Boy, you've got a great inheritance. Go and claim it." The boy smiled for the first time in a long time, and he walked out the door a changed person. He was never the same again. Whenever anybody asked him, "Who's your daddy?" he'd just tell them, I'm a child of God. Can't you tell?" The distinguished gentleman got up from the table and he said, "Isn't that a great story?" The professor responded and said, "It sure is." As the man turned to leave, he said, "You know, if that new preacher hadn't told me that I was one of God's children, I probably never would have amounted to anything." And he walked away. The waitress grinned and she said, the seminary professor and his wife were stunned. He called the waitress over and he asked her, "Do you know who the man that just left who was sitting at our table, who is he?" And the waitress, of course, grinned and she said, "Of course I do. Everybody knows him. That's Ben Hooper. He's the former governor of the state of Tennessee." Father God, knowing that I belong to you gives me great comfort, joy, and assurance. Help me to live each day in the fullness of the inheritance that you supply for me as your child. Well, this morning's message could be "A Few Good Men, Daddy Knows Best," or "Who's Your Daddy?" So we'll run through this real quickly because we want you to understand that God has a principle. He has a foundation for you as dads, as men. Ezekiel 22:30, "And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found none." Two or three prerequisites for being a godly father. You will not be a good father until you are a good man. It's a dying art today. Thank God we do have good men right here at the First Union Congregational Church, affectionately called the Congo, affectionately called the what? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. The what? We've got good men here. We can always use more. Ladies, I'm going to give you a few tips on men this morning. I hope you listen closely. This is the men's thesaurus. We don't always say what we mean, ladies. Don't read ahead. That's not fair. Let me translate it for you. When a man says, "It wouldn't take too long to explain," he means, "I have no idea how it works." None whatsoever. When a man says, "Take a break, honey, you're working too hard," he really means, "I can't hear the game over the vacuum sweeper." And when a man says, "Take a break, baby, you're working too hard," I already said that. When a man says, "That's interesting, dear," he means, "Are you still talking?" Men, don't laugh too loud on that one. When a man says it's a guy thing, he means there is no rational thought pattern connected with this, and you have no chance of making it logical. When a man says, "Can I help you with dinner?" he means, "Why isn't it ready?" That's so true, so true. When a man says, "Uh-huh, sure, honey," or "Yes, dear," he means absolutely nothing. It's a conditioned response. When a man says, "Oh, don't fuss, I just cut myself, it's no big deal," he means, "I probably severed a limb, but I will bleed to death before I admit I'm hurt, so get over here and help me." You know exactly what I'm talking about. When a man says, "You look terrific," he means, "Oh, please don't try on another outfit. We're late for dinner, and I'm starving to death." When a man says, "That's not what I meant," he means, "If something I said can be interpreted two ways, and one of the ways makes you sad or angry, I meant the other one." We thank God for the good men that he has sent here to the Congo today. Good men are men who've learned to lean on the Lord, who trust in the Lord, who lean on the Lord for salvation, who lean on the Lord for supply, who lean on the Lord for their flesh, their families, and the fallen. One of the things I wanted to do this morning was just share with you a little bit about my dad. Probably a lot like your father. My dad was born in New Florence, Missouri. Does anybody know where New Florence, Missouri is? Do you? And he was the son of a railroad executive. And my dad had a childhood that consisted of baseball, baseball, and baseball. He loved to play baseball. As a matter of fact, he loved it so much, he went to Culver Stockton, played college at Culver Stockton, and then tried to get a minor league contract. He was a pitcher, and he threw his arm out, and when he threw his arm out, he turned around and began to pitch left-handed. He learned how to throw left-handed. He was ambidextrous. He was also Baptist, but he was also Baptist. Okay. But he was ambidextrous. So he began to try to make it in the minor leagues. That did not work. He met my mother, fell in love. When they fell in love, they moved right here to Quincy, Illinois. And my sister and my brother were both born here in Quincy, Illinois. And they went to part of their grade school here. Then my dad and my mother moved to St. Louis, to that town, the notorious town that I'm sure most of you are familiar with, one of the greatest towns in Missouri, where I was raised, Ferguson, Missouri. That's where I was raised. Great town, incredible town, wonderful childhood. My dad would come home from work every day, and he would do everything he could within his power to provide for his children, for his family. But one of the things that he did that was as important, if not more so than anything, he took us to church every Sunday. Now, for me, since I was the youngest, Rob, he took me to church on Sunday morning. Just make sure you're awake. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and Thursday night. Thursday night was choir practice. Wednesday night was prayer meeting. Sunday night was church training and church. And Sunday morning was Sunday school and church. And I began to think that we didn't have a house, that we just lived in the church. And what I would do when I was real young, I would go back to the back during choir practice, of course, and slide. They had these linoleum floors. I would slide all the way underneath the pews down to the front. In other words, I was the custodian, and I was cleaning the floor for the church, the auditorium. And as much as I would whine and as much as I would complain, I remember those days affectionately. I remember those days with love because my dad cared enough about me to not just teach me how to throw a baseball through the basement window, not only loved me enough to teach me how to hit a baseball, not only taught me enough to provide for my food and my substance, but he loved me even more than that. He loved me enough to teach me about God, my Heavenly Father. So I would say this morning on Father's Day, we celebrate fathers, we celebrate the memory of our dads, some of whom have gone on before us, and we also celebrate the recognition that a good dad or a good man is a man who loves God, who loves his family, who loves God's church, and a man who, above all else, lives life with integrity from beginning to end. Jesus was not an earthly father. The Holy Spirit is not an earthly father. But God is a spiritual father to those who come to know him and love him. You've heard me tell the story, probably, of when a friend of mine told me, he said, I'll tell you what, man, Saturday mornings are just, they're awful. And I said, well, what do you mean they're awful? He said, every Saturday morning, somebody knocks on my door. Every Saturday morning. And they're talking to me about this religion. They're handing me magazines. Every Saturday morning. I don't know what to do. Well, I didn't know what to do. I didn't even think about it again until one Saturday morning. One Saturday morning, I was at the house, and guess what? I looked out the window, and I saw this sweet little lady taking her bag out of the car and walking up to the house and ringing my doorbell, knocking on the door. When I opened the door, I said, hold it. Before you say a thing,
Don't say a word. Before you say anything, I want you to pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And she said, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I said, can you sing Amazing Grace? She sang Amazing Grace, note perfect grace. And then I said, put your hand on the Bible. She did. And then I said, what have you got to say for yourself? She said, I've been selling Avon for 43 years and never had anything like this ever happen to me, ever. Never, ever had anything like this happen to me. Sometimes we say things that we don't mean. Sometimes we as men make decisions on our own. But I would encourage you this morning, as a father, as a man, to listen to the smartest person that God has put into your life, your wife. Sorry, Bo. Listen to the smartest person who God has put into. She is your partner, your life partner. And if you're not married and your mother's still around, listen to mom. Amen, ladies?
Amen.
Thank you. And if there's nobody else around to talk to get advice from, and even if there is, listen to God. Let God do what he wants to do in your life. This morning, we live in a world that is built on chaos. Chaos. We're seeing things happen that our fathers and our mothers and our grandfathers would roll in their graves. They would be mortified if they saw what was going on in the world today and in some churches. But I want to tell you, I want to encourage you, this church here, we're on the right track. This church here, the Congo, we're seeing God move in ways that we never even ever dreamed. And our expectations and our hopes are beyond any description. Because God's raising up godly men, and he's raising up godly women. This morning, I hope that you will. Look, if you've never connected to the church, or you did at one time, and you're thinking, I'm back, sort of, I want you to think in terms of connecting to the ministry of the congregational church, to the ministry of the people here who love you, who have prayed for you, and who are willing to work side by side with you. Would you bow your heads for just a moment? Chuck, would you come? And I just want to ask you one question. You see, I've got enough Baptists in me to want to know that you have given your life. You've given your heart to Jesus Christ. When you hear the song, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So, do tears well up in your eyes? Does your heart begin to beat a little bit faster? When you hear the old rugged cross, or when you hear some of these How Great Is Our God, and some of these incredible worship songs, is there something in you that stirs up and says to you, son, remember me? I'm your daddy. If there is, respond to that voice, even today, even now.
I'm going to ask you to stand, will you please? Men, we leave our wives and our families to Jesus. We lead them in so many ways. It's so important for us to lead them in the way of the Lord. It's so important for us to be more than just visitors to our home and to our family. So important for us to be a counselor for our kids. So I'm going to sing this little chorus as I sing it. You say this morning, yeah, baby, you know you're right. When you sing a song, when the choir sings, or when pastor preaches, or when parents sing, or others sing, something does stir up within my heart. And you know what? I want to serve God right here in this place, the First Union Congregational Church. I want to be the father. I want to be the husband. I want to be the man that God wants me to be. If you'd like to make that public, and I will right now, I'll take your stand for it right now. I'll say I want to make that stand. I know Chuck wants to make that stand. Would there be others who would say, would you come and take Brother Chuck by the hand and say, yes, I vote for God. Every time I vote for the Lord, yes, I will serve him and I will be the man that God wants. Would you come right now as I say?
Give Bruce a big hand. We appreciate him and love him. We love you, man. Thank you for your words this morning. Have a great Father's Day today. And to all the rest of you, have a great Father's Day. Join us for some goodies here and some time to get to chat, know one another. Let's pray together as we close. God, we thank you for the words of truth that we've heard today, where you are speaking into our ears and you're speaking into our hearts and you're saying, come after me. I am the source of life. I am the sustenance of life. Stay close to me. And God, I pray that every word that's been spoken, every word we've received this morning from you, it would take deep root into our lives and it would bear fruit. We would be different people and continually growing in strength in our relationship with God and in our service for Jesus Christ to this world and to one another. In Jesus' name. Everyone said, amen. Have a great day. Amen.